Who here is a fan of The Walking Dead? Any Walking Dead? Okay, a few, the same three from the first service snuck into the second service. I knew I shouldn't have used a dated situation, but here we are. The Walking Dead. The Walking Dead is it's a all-time TV show, has been around for a long time, and one of the most watched shows. I've actually not seen very much of The Walking Dead either, so I'm a little bit of a hypocrite. But what's interesting to me about The Walking Dead is just the title. The show is about living and surviving in a world with zombies. And when I picture a zombie, what I imagine from a zombie is this sort of ravenous, consumption-driven creature that's just barely alive. It's alive, but it's not truly living. It's the line there. It's alive, but it's not truly living. It's a walking dead. Love the title, The Walking Dead. Alive, but not really living. I think through sometimes about the American Christian landscape, and I wonder if zombie better illustrates what we sometimes see. That we are alive in Christ, but we're not living in Christ. And what does it mean to be alive in Christ and not living in Christ? What does it mean to be the walking dead in the kingdom of God? In this series, we've been talking about the seven signs. This is the seventh of the signs that we have experienced or we have walked through. A quick review of some of the signs that we have covered already. We know that Jesus turned water into wine. He heals the official's son. He heals a paralyzed man. He fed 5,000, heals a lame man, and brings sight to the blind. And here in this seventh sign, we have Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And one of the things that Libin said early in the series that I think is important for us today is that sometimes with Jesus, we pay a lot of attention to the sign and not to whom the sign is pointing to. That the miracle gets all of the publicity while the miracle worker slides into the background. And in the story of Lazarus, that could be true as well. That we could get locked in and focused in on the miracle of raising Lazarus from the dead, that we would miss the main point that the sign is pointing to, which is that Jesus is the source of life. Fun fact, Lazarus may not make it past chapter 12. So the story isn't so much about Lazarus. In fact, the story isn't about the miracle. The story is about life, and his name is Jesus. So we read the passage today. So I want to zoom in a little bit on sort of the piece that I really want to focus in on today. And that's verses 20 through 25. Read those with me. It says, as soon as Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary remained seated in the house. I don't know what this Mary and Martha rivalry situation is about. It's just showing up all over the place. Then Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Yet even now I know that whatever you ask from him, God will give you. He says, your brother will rise again. And Jesus told her, and Martha said to him, I know that he will rise in the resurrection in the last day. And here's where I want us to zoom in. If you're taking notes or if you want to underline or if you got your digitals out, you can bold this. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. Say a prayer with me as we begin to jump in. Father God, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Oh God, you are my strength and my redeemer. I am just a nobody, trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. Hide me behind the cross and let whatever is said and done today, that you get the glory, that your Son is exalted and that your Holy Spirit is manifested in our lives. This is your servant's prayer, in Jesus' name, amen. Three things we want to cover today. One, there's more to life than death. Two, the source of true life. And three, living fully alive and awake. Let's start with there's more to life than death. In verse 25, Jesus says, the one who believes in me, even if he dies, he will live. And at the very minimum, this is a confusing, if not contradictive, statement. What does Jesus mean by the fact that even though we die, he will live if we believe in him? The disciples had it all mixed up, and it makes sense that they would. As you look at the account, you see that Jesus doesn't treat death with the urgency that we expect him to treat it with. First, he gets the news from Lazarus, and he delays 2 days and starts to move on the third day, and that ought to sound familiar. Something about the third day, but that's not today. But he delays for 2 days, and they're like, well, Jesus, if you're going to save him, what are we waiting on? So it seems like Jesus is not moving with the urgency in response to death that we would expect him to. Sometimes it's true in our lives as well. But also, when Jesus does decide to do it, they're like, wait a minute, but you're going to save him, but you're going to go into dangerous territory to do it. You're going to go back to the place where they're going to stone you? They got a hit out for you over there? And Jesus doesn't respect the danger, the impact of the danger of death. And they're confused by it. They're like, Jesus, we done already healed people from afar. Like, we did this with the son. Like, you don't have to go. Like, you could just say he's healed. And it would, why are you going into danger? Be practical. Jesus says, no, I'm going to go ahead and head on in. And then the third thing we see is that Jesus calls it sleep. He doesn't treat death with the impact we expect. He says he's just asleep. And they're like, is he asleep? Oh, if he's just asleep, then somebody need to go wake him up. That's pretty much they're like, hey, if he's sleeping, just shake his feet. Then go ahead and get up. And Jesus says, no, I mean he's dead. And Jesus doesn't treat death with the impact that they expect, the urgency, the danger, the impact. Jesus sees death differently than the disciples do. And this is the part that really messed with me as I'm studying this passage. It's in John 11, 15, and this is what he says. He says to the disciples, I'm glad for you that I wasn't there. Pause. I'm glad for your sake that I was not there. Like, wait a minute. When did we get into this? Like, it was Lazarus. Lazarus is sick. And Jesus says, no, I've got something that I want to teach you about your belief in this scenario. He says, I'm glad I wasn't there so that you may believe. So let's go to him. Now, this is interesting because the disciples are the ones who believe Jesus the most. They are living with Jesus. They're walking and talking with Jesus. They've seen all the signs. Some of them they've performed. These are not the ones that we would expect Jesus to say does not believe in him. And yet there's something about the disciples' perspective around life and around death that is disconnected with Jesus. He says, I'm glad for your sake that I didn't go so that you, the disciples, would believe. A similar interaction we get with Martha. He shows up to Martha, and Martha's like, yeah, man, if you'd have been here just a few, days ago, I feel like she was kind of like, I don't know if she was like being sarcastic or passive aggressive. I don't know. Martha doesn't seem like the passive aggressive type. But she comes in and she's like, hey, if you'd have just been here, like, I know that you could have saved him. She's got remarkable belief in Jesus. And yet, Jesus says to her, hey, I'm the resurrection and the life. She's like, yeah, I know, for later. And he's like, no, now, do you believe this? a similar type of challenge to the disciples. Do you believe this? Martha, of course, Martha's like, yeah, I believe that. But the fact that Jesus is asking implies that maybe she doesn't believe it fully. That there's something that Martha and the disciples need to know and learn and believe better about Jesus and about life based on this sign of raising Lazarus from the dead. And so this sign is not just for the lost. It's not just for those persons who had not yet met Jesus and he was about to do this miraculous thing. Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead was just as much for the disciples and Martha as it was for everyone else. So why is that? Why is that? And this is what I think is true. I think that Martha and the disciples are living from what I call the paradigm of death. And I think we can sympathize with Martha and the disciples because we too live from this paradigm of death. What do I mean by paradigm of death? In the paradigm of death, we see death as the ultimate enemy. It is the realest and most urgent and most potent thing in our lives. It's the shadow that's shading our lives, the big dark cloud that follows over us. And because death is this real and potent and urgent to us, we make everyday decisions, life and death decisions, in relationship to death. Sin and death, rather, it was introduced to us through Romans 5. Actually, it's introduced through sin. Romans 5 talks about it. We don't have time to get deeply into this whole thing, so hopefully this will do. Therefore, it says in Romans 5, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, in this way death spread to all people because all sin. So death is coming for all of us, and we know it. And because of this, we make everyday decisions to run from or to distance ourselves from death. Sin and death entices us, listen to me, sin and death entices us to swap the priority of a qualitative spiritual life defined by God with a qualitative physical, social, and emotional life defined by us. That's what death does. It turns what life is meant to be upside down. Where God had established a creation full of harmony and beauty, free from death, sin establishes a creation filled with fear and death, free from harmony. And you don't have to take my word for it. You can open up, turn on your TV, open up your app, walk upstairs in your house, and you'll find disharmony is rampant because death is all around us. We're living from this place of death. Death has become the primary motivator of our actions, choices, and decisions. Death has become the primary motivator of our actions, choices, and decisions. It replaces harmony with hierarchy. Says, hey, there's God created everything to have, to lean and to blend and to be and to coexist, to mutually serve, but we've turned harmony into hierarchy. Sin has replaced desire, or rather design with desire. What God had designed is replaced with desire. Our desires. Our desires become more important than the role we are meant to play in creation. It motivates us. We make life and death decisions on a day-by-day basis, hour-by-hour basis. Let's dig into it a little bit more. There's three things I want to look at again. This is not comprehensive. But three aspects of this paradigm of death I want to look at today. The first is scarcity. What death produces, why we do this, right? How does this affect the way we live? Antoine, you're saying all this ideological stuff. How does this affect the way we live? Well, we live from a mindset of scarcity. Scarcity tells us that there is something to lose, that there is not enough for all of us. And as a result, in order to live, in order to beat death, we've got to amass as many resources as possible. We're worried about losing. It's a zero-sum game that there's not enough. So I've got to, in order for me to win, you've got to lose. In order for me to move forward, you've got to step back. In order for me to rise, you must fall. We compete and we compare because we feel that the resources is not enough. It's the COVID toilet paper situation. And we live our lives stacking our garages with toilet paper, afraid that there's not enough for everybody. Only it's not toilet paper. It's life, it's worth, it's value. We begin to try to pursue these things and amass them because we feel that if we don't get the attention and the respect and the praise that we deserve, that we will somehow be left out, that we will lose. And to lose is to die, to lose is death. The second is survival. We have scarcity that teaches us about loss, and then survival teaches us about fear. Finish the sentence. The strongest survive. That's the rule of the jungle, and it's the rule of the civilized jungle, the jungle we live in. The strongest survive. And we think the best way to beat death is to be the strongest, to be the prettiest, to be the whatever the est is. We've got to be strong. We've got to win. And the reason we have to do that because survival produces a fear of being consumed. Because if we're not strong, if we're not the predator, we become the prey in society. We're worried about being eaten. It's a dog-eat-dog world, and we want to be the dog that's doing the eating, not the dog that's being eaten. So we spend our lives trying to prove that we're not the one to be messed with, that we're not the one to be consumed, that we're not the ones to be exploited, because we feel like that's going to help us survive. We have a fear of being dismissed, of not mattering enough, not just of being strong, but also being dismissed. We don't want to be the bottom of that hierarchy I was talking about, because we know that the bottom is where death arrives. So we want to distance ourselves in the gated community of metaphorically and sometimes even physically, as we try to distance ourselves from death. There's a fear of rejection. Feeling of the fear of being unworthy or feeling unloved, of not being picked, being shamed. These are things that make us feel like we're close to death. Listen to this. To be deemed not worthy means not only being easily dismissed or discarded, but to be accepted and to be valued is to feel safe, and to be rejected and belittled and hated feels dangerous. When we feel accepted, it feels safe, doesn't it? When you feel hated or you feel dismissed, you feel unsafe, it feels dangerous. It's a way of thinking about life. We are worried about rejection. The last piece of it is self-centered and ego. In self-centeredness, we have pride, and really this just says that you're on your own. It says that, hey, I determine what is good and evil. I define myself and my purpose. And usually that's centered around my pleasure and my comfort. It's funny how that is. When we start to take control over our purpose, then we align that purpose with our pleasure and our comfort. Right? We do that. We say, hey, I'm going to do that. I need to take care of number one. It's my self-interest alone. I am not my brother's keeper. I get what I earn. I pull myself up by my own bootstraps. I am a self-made man. I don't need nobody's help. I do it all on my own. It's me, self-centered, a flashing sign that says what's in it for me is driving our decisions, our self-interests, our interest convergence with life, where we make choices, and the best choices are the ones we win from. My dad's a preacher. And I heard this growing up a lot where he would say, hey, you might have pulled yourself up by the bootstraps, by your own bootstraps, but somebody gave you the boots. The idea is that you are not in this thing by yourself. That it is a fallacy to believe that you can be a self-made man. That the reality is that we are meant to be in community. We are meant to mutually serve. We are not isolated. We are not designed just to take care of number one. I am my brother's keeper. So we try, we fight. We fight for worth. We contend for our place on your hierarchy. We compete to win. This is what it means to live in the paradigm of death. Always worry that at any moment, something could be taken from you. Someone could remove your value, and somehow you're gonna let yourself down. This is not the way that Jesus and God designed for us to experience life. C.S. Lewis says it this way. He says, the moment you have a self at all, there is a possibility of putting yourself first, wanting to be the center, wanting to be God, in fact. That was the sin of Satan, and that was the sin he taught the human race. What Satan put into the heads of our remote ancestors was the idea that they could be like gods, could set up on their own as if they had created themselves, be their own masters, invent some sort of happiness for themselves outside of God, apart from God. And out of that hopeless attempt has come nearly all we call human history: money, poverty, ambition, war, prostitution, classes, empires, slavery. The long, terrible story of man trying to find something other than God which will make him happy. This is the zombie life. This is the walking dead. Alive, but not truly living. Consumed by the desires and the ravenous desire to get and to satisfy desires. This groaning and grotesque picture of a zombie. Alive and animated, but not truly living. Jesus offers another way. In Matthew 10, 28, he says, don't fear him who could destroy the body, but fear him who could destroy the body and the soul. In 2 Corinthians, he says, though the outward man perishes, the inward man is renewed day by day. And in today's passage, Jesus is saying, even though if you believe in me, even though a man dies, he can live. There's more to life than death. True life is not defined by fear and shame and scarcity. And Jesus would not be controlled by this paradigm of death, which is why he was so confusing in his responses. Jesus worked from a different thing. Okay, number two, the source of true life. We said earlier this story is not about Lazarus, it's about life, and his name is Jesus. So let's look back at the passage in 25 to 26. It says, I am the resurrection and the life. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Now, we just talked about the paradigm of death, and we're so used to living out of this paradigm of death that we begin to see Jesus as a resource in that paradigm. And so he seems like the ultimate power-up. If you're a video, I don't know, if you're a video Mario Brothers, like, he is the star in the, like, he's just, you get the star, you just run through everybody. You don't even have to, that's gonna miss a lot of you. It's just a power-up. It just means that you don't really die when you would normally, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. But the idea is that we begin to see Jesus as a resource to life, as a resource, as something that's going to help us in the paradigm of death, which is not what he's saying. It's not our fault, though. We've kind of grown up in a lot of Christian culture with a BS theology. BS stands for benefit statement. Oh, you can release. Go ahead and take it. If somebody was writing it down right away, like, canceled. All right. No, it's a BS theology. It's a benefit statement theology, a theology that teaches that the value that Christ brings us is the value is related to his benefit to us. To say it more quickly, we'll follow Jesus for the miracles, but not for the ministry. We'll follow Jesus for the blessings, but not for the obedience. We'll say, Lord, save me, not Lord, use me. Because at the end of the day, Jesus is the tool to win in the paradigm of death for many of us. And that's not what he sets himself up to be. Our greatest needs often become our greatest distraction. Our greatest needs often become our greatest distraction. If you're struggling with loneliness, you come to church for community, not Christ. When you can come and find Christ, and with him comes community. When we grow angry with God, when he doesn't heal us or those we love, because we think, what practical use is serving a God who could heal if he doesn't heal in a paradigm of death? We hesitate to serve when it's convenient. Boy, the stars got to align, the planets need to be in full, you know, situation. It's got to be real. You know, we've got to coax it out of you. Like, hey, you know what? If you come and serve, it's going to be amazing for you. Oh, man, if you're going to do a mission, you know what? I learned so much about God when I was doing mission. It somehow, it needs to benefit us. We're in a benefit statement society. That's what we're used to doing. The culture has taught us that we should move to the places that we gain from. And so even in church, we say, I can't get good servants in the church unless I tell them that they'll benefit. Or it's convenient. We consider charity. This is a funny thing, man. We talk about charity. We say, man, we give charity. Man, I give away the clothes that I don't want. They're doing me the favor. I'm not doing them a favor. Like I put clothes in a bag. I'm like, man, I'm done with these. Do y'all want them? Like, that is not charity. I'm just here to tell you. It's not. I mean, I know you want to feel good, get your tax redone, but it ain't charity. Like, it benefits us to get rid of the clothes, and it happens to work out that someone else can use them. It's not the same. There's a benefit. We're driven by our own benefit. We accept the grace of God, but not the mission of God. We see Christ as a resource to escape death, not as the source of life. And when we do this as a church, we create environments that are influenced by the paradigm of death. Suddenly, in God's house, we have hierarchies and jungles. And the rules of scarcity and survival and self-centeredness show up in places where they're not meant to in God's house. Suddenly, we have places where people need to measure up to belong. They gotta be cool enough, or they can't be awkward, too awkward. We gotta be a place that satisfies some consumeristic impulses. Needs to be comfortable, coffee, smoke. It needs to feel, you know, we need to feel like we're on top of the game as we're one of the better churches. Consumeristic impulses. We become places filled with VIP sections. And we're filled with people who must look, talk, and worship just like us. And there's no room for anyone else. Because, boy, do we love us. And we really love us when you look like us. I love me, and I love when I see me in you. And that becomes the basis of connection. That's not the Jesus way. Because what happens when I don't see me in you? It's what happens. These places, they become our, we become zombie, the echoes of the world outside, zombie lands. Using Christ and his church to solve our paradigm of death issue instead of bringing life to those who come into our environments. Jesus is not a resource for life. He is the source of life. In Romans 12:2, it says, do not be conformed to the patterns of this world, to this paradigm of death, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will see and then you will know what the good will of God is. We cannot live our lives as though Jesus is a resource to our life plans and ideas. We must, with transformed minds, humble ourselves to Christ as the source of life and align ourselves with him. When we do this, it changes how we treat each other. It changes how we see each other. It's no longer me that I'm looking for in you. It's Christ that I see in you, and Christ has immeasurable value. And as a result, I connect with the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me connects with the Jesus in you. Now, what was separated becomes integrated. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, it's Christ who lives in me. Christ changes the motivation. Where death was the primary motivator for how we make choices and how we live and how we interface this fear of survival and scarcity, Christ changes all of that, and he becomes the primary motivator for our choices and our lives and our decisions. And this is not new. This is not new. This is, John 11 is not a new thing. John has been saying this for the entire book of John. Let me prove it to you. You don't believe me. I know you don't. Okay, so in John 1, it says, in him was life. Him is Jesus, and that life was the light of man. Jesus says of himself, he's going to destroy the temple, and he will raise it up in 3 days as the source of life. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. John 4 says, I will give you a water in you, it's a well springing up to eternal life, is what he says in John 4. We're still in John. John 5, he says, truly I tell you, anyone who hears my words and believes in him will be given eternal life. John 6, I am the bread of life. John 7, you will have streams of living water flowing through you to eternal life. John 8, truly I tell you, if anyone keeps my word, he will not see death. John 10, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. John 14, I am the truth, the way, the truth, and the life. Throughout the whole set, John is trying to tell us that Jesus is the source from life. And from that is what we begin to live the best way to live. That is true life through Jesus. Jesus is the inexhaustible source of life. And when we believe it, this is what he asked us to do. Do you believe this? And when we believe it, it offers an entirely different paradigm. So we had a paradigm of death. Let's look at a paradigm of life. Instead of scarcity, we have abundance. Instead of loss, we have trust. Jesus said, I want you to have life and to have it more abundantly. It's not a race of resources. The resources are set. I do not have to compete and compare. I don't need to live into a VIP kind of mindset. Out of abundance, I can make room for a heart of love, not fear. Out of abundance, I can produce a heart to serve, not to consume or seize power. Out of a heart of abundance, I see the image of God alive in people around me, not rivals to compete with or exploit. It's from this place of abundance that there's no such thing as sacrifice, because you're never losing anything. If it's an inexhaustible source, then it's never not full, no matter how much you give out of it. And so it's never sacrifice, it's just service. It's just service. This is how you can do it. This is how it works, that the community can give itself away to each other because it's never losing anything. How would it change the way we live as a church? How would it change how we enter into this room if we didn't walk in expecting something to fill a hole that should be filled already, and instead expecting to scoop out of that filling into the lives of each other? As the Spirit wills. Abundance. And the second one is service. Instead of survival, it's service. I don't have to fear being at the bottom. I can just love. Scripture says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all the rest of this stuff will be added. Amen. He was talking about needs then in the passage in Matthew. It was about clothes and the tulips and whether they were to eat, and the sparrow, that's what he was talking about. He was talking about this real life stuff. He's like, seek ye first the kingdom. And if you do that, then you'll be all right. Christ is our identity when Christ is the source of life. And in him, we have full worth and love that no one can add to or no one can take away. And so when we come into a set, we don't need others to validate us. We're validated. We don't need love from others. We are loved. Because we have nothing to gain from people, we're in perfect position to give to people. You're not coming with closing fists, you're coming with opening fists. It's a difference. It's a difference. The world is not doing that. And then not self-led, but spirit-led. Holy lives. I know that freaks some people out to say holy. Listen, it's real simple. It's just set apart. It just means that you have a specific role to play in the harmony. That in the orchestra, you're the violin. Put the drumsticks down and play your song. Because when you do that, the music is beautiful. Holiness is just living into God's purposes for you in light of the picture of the whole. That's the harmony. That's the design that we give away for our desires. Scripture says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, in Philippians 2:6. And in that passage, he says, like, what mind? This mind, it says, where Jesus didn't use his equality with God to his own advantage. Not like the self-centered, what's in it for me kind of thinking that says, whatever advantages I have, I'm gonna use them for my own interest. No, Jesus is like, I have the ultimate advantage in being the creator of the universe, and I set that completely down to serve. Let this mind be in you. Not to use your skills and your talents and your gifts for your own advantage, but in submission and surrender to the will of God, for the good purposes of God, for the kingdom of God, and the mission of God. It's a better way. Martha was loving it. Not really. Martha kind of was like, yeah. This sounds like stuff for later. Oh, that sounds real good. I know all this is going to happen for later. And Jesus is like, no. It's really right now. This is now. That's what Martha needed to get. That's what maybe some of us need to get. Some of this is freaking some of you out. You're like, I don't know what that actually looks like. That's because you're scared of death. Because it's all around us. But what would happen if we, God's people, showed the world another way? Boy. Okay. Last piece. Living alive and awake. So Jesus asked Martha in verse 26, he said, do you believe this? That's the question before you and I. Do you believe this? Let me be real with you for a second. The realest thing in you're going to respond to the realest thing in your life. And the truth is, you don't need any faith to understand death, depression, anxiety, poverty. What else do I have written here? Sickness. All that stuff is real. No faith required. That's actually right in front of you. You don't need proof. So just as real as Martha's brother was in a grave is these death pictures in front of us. And that's real to us. But the question is, do you believe that Jesus is more than that? Do you believe that Jesus is bigger than the death things around us? Do you really believe Jesus is the resurrection and the life? Earlier in the passage, Jesus referred to death as sleep. And I believe that this picture is one of the ways that we may show that we don't believe. Some of us are dead and living from a dead paradigm. Some of us are alive, but asleep. Alive in Christ, but asleep. We kind of got this sedative, chill kind of thing that we got going on. We're asleep. Alive, but asleep. Not moving, not active. And then, of course, we have the zombie life where we're alive, but we're living or we're moving out of a death paradigm. But oh, what it would be if the church would fully live and fully believe that Christ is the source. Not a dead church full of dry bones. Not a sleeping church, alive but animated, but not animated. Not a zombie church, a walking dead church that's alive in Christ but living from a paradigm of death, but an awake and alive church living free from death, fully from our identity in Christ, fueled by Christ's love on his mission. So here's the invitation. To those feeling dead in this room, hear these words from Ezekiel 37 as he prophesies to the dry bones. He says, this is what the Lord God says. I am going to open your graves, and you don't have to live this dead life. I'm going to open your graves and give you up from them, bring you up from them, my people, and lead you into the land of Israel. You will know that I am the Lord, my people, when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live. And I will settle you in your land. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I have spoken, and I will do it. For those of us who are sleepwalking in Christ, listen to the words of the Ephesians, where he says, get up, sleeper, and rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Pay careful attention then how you walk, sleeper, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So don't be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is, and don't get drunk with wine, which leads to reckless living, but be filled by the Spirit. And for those of us who are living in Christ, but living from a paradigm of death, listen to what Romans 13 has to say. Romans 13 says, besides this, since you know the time, it is already the hour for you to wake from sleep, because now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is nearly over and the day is near. So let us discard the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk with decency as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, our desires, not in sexual immorality and promiscuity, our desires, not in quarreling and jealousy, our comparative and competitive natures, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. To all of us, Jesus says this last thing in our passage, as he calls Lazarus out from the grave, he says in verse 43 to 44, Lazarus, with a loud voice, Lazarus, I can't do it. I don't have the energy for the loud voice. Lazarus, come out. That's to all of us. Wake and sleep. Living off the wrong paradigm. Come out. And the dead man came out, and his hands and feet wrapped in strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to him, take off those grave clothes and let them go. Amen? Amen. Bow your heads with me. Father God, Father, we pray that this is a moment that you begin to show us where we have not held you as the source for life. God, we confess that so often in our world and in the way that we live, that we utilize you as an ancillary piece to our life goals. That you're the hammer, or you're the tool, you're the resource for what we want out of life as we try to run from death. And I pray that in this world, that in this time, that you would be the source for us. And because of that, Father, that we would know that we are fully loved and that we have full worth and we have full confidence in you, that we don't need to live in fear, and we don't need to fear what would happen to us, God, that we would have the things that we need. I pray that we would be a church, God, that we would be a place that exemplifies that life, that we would be not a zombie graveyard, not a place that people have to scrap and claw in order to matter, but rather, God, that we would be a place that loves and loves extravagantly and loves completely, with you as the source for our lives. God, we love you so much, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.